just to say a few words about my organization I'm representing here, and also its programs across the globe, as well as in Ethiopia, because I came from Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, next door. CIPE stands for Center for International Private Enterprise, which is an international NGO based in Washington, D.C., working across the globe, mainly in East Europe, Latin America, Asia, as well as in Africa. Back in my home, in Ethiopia, so I've started working for the last 15 years. The last 8 years, I'm managing the program in Ethiopia. We have more than 85 partner DMOs, business membership organizations, mainly regional chambers, city chambers, sectoral associations, women and youth entrepreneurial associations, and similar. We do have different kind of programs, a very comprehensive capacity building program to create capacity for Ethiopian DMOs to engage finally on public policy advocacy, mainly on business policy. We do have a training program that focuses on the leadership and management, as well as the staff of associations across the country. In fact, recently we are in the process of establishing a chamber academy with the collaboration of the National Chamber, the Ethiopian Chamber of Commerce, and sectoral association. We do have also a program on policy advocacy. We call it public-private dialogue, focus on the regions, because Ethiopia has a federal structure. We have 9 regional states and 2 federal cities, Addis Ababa and Reda. So the chamber structure follows the federal structure. So we engage on different kind of policy issues with each regional governments, as well as with the federal government. We do also technical assistance, which is basically depending on the needs and the capacity of each associations that are operating in Ethiopia. I'm here just, we invited by Shuraako, Lee and his team. Thank you for that. So hopefully we'll engage more and expand the Ethiopian program, SIPE program, here to Somaliland with the collaboration of Shuraako. Just coming back to our session, for the sake of utilizing our time, for us it's allotted an hour and a half for this session. So I would like to suggest a few in-house rules. The first 3-4 minutes, I will introduce the 4 panelists from my right hand. Then I will have a brief presentation about the role of chambers and associations that will serve us as initial discussion for further engagement, even though the expertise will talk more about specific and tangible issues next to my presentation. Finally, we'll have a question and answer session. We'd like to have more discussion with the audience. And finally, the last 5 to 10 minutes, we'll allot the time for the panelists to address questions that are forwarded by participants. So I think we're a little bit behind time, so I'll start by introducing the finalists. From my right hand, Abdirashid H. Mohamed is the head of External Relations, Somaliland Chamber of Commerce. Next to him, Jamaal, Aydid, he is a vice chair, Somaliland Industry Association. Next to him, Warsame Mohamed. He has two titles, Research and Community Service Director. He's also working for some Somaliland Economic Association. Then next to him, lady, very active. I saw her a very interesting presentation yesterday. Sucaad, Odowa. She is the president of Association for Women in Business. So now, as I said, for the sake of time, I will go directly to my presentation. Is that okay? Good. So I will, my presentation, try to deal with these five points on the purpose of and rules of business associations in general, and also the future trends of business association, and how BMOs or business association could provide services and programs to their members. And finally, the major topic, how BMOs or business membership organization could engage in public policy advocacy. Any strong business association supposed to harness the capacity of the private sector. By the way, chamber is a very known brand. Any country, whether it's developing or developed, whether it's to the west, east, except the Vatican, every country has a chamber. So it's a very known brand. So every chamber, even though they have different kind of formalities and capacities, they're supposed to harness the capacity of the private sector. They are representing the private sector interest. Then they create business opportunity for their own constituencies as well as beyond. They also protect the interest of both companies and employees. So business could be run at any format. It could be at company or at individual level. So BMOs should protect the interest of all kind of businesses. Business associations also they promote civil society. Broadly speaking, civil society includes NGOs as well as associations. So associations are part and parcel of the broad civil society. And also they enhance business climate, especially by engaging on advocacy issues with their local as well as any kind of format with the government. And also they help combat corruption. And also finally, they provide social goods to society. For future associations, they for their future success, they supposed to use technology, not only for the private sector, any kind of business, whether it is at private or public, any organization should utilize, especially these states at 21st century, IT, information technology. So they should start utilizing IT technology, especially associations that are working in developing countries like our region, like it could be in Somaliland and Ethiopia. They should also enable to embracing strategic planning as a value-added process. Any association should have a strategic plan. In terms of time, usually, a strategic plan, it could be from 3 to 5 years. So any association should have a vision, should have a mission, objective, and also action plan, as well as some kind of system to measure their activities. So finally, they should evaluate, or they should have some kind of system to evaluate their programs. For the sake of time, I'm not going to deal with each point. I would like to skip to the second major point, which is the challenge. What kind of challenges are facing these days, especially associations or chambers that are working in developing or transitional economy? The first thing, within the chamber or association system or outside of that, they have the lack of business association mentality. Especially in Africa, many countries in Africa, they were under the socialism or communist kind of mentality. So still, they have this old kind of thinking. The second part still is associated with old kind of mentality. People, they don't trust associations or businesses. The private sector sometimes consider associations or chambers as some kind of extension to the public sector or agents of government. So there is some kind of lack of trust from the business community toward this associations. The third major constraint, lack of communication. They don't communicate their members. They don't communicate with similar associations. It could be at national or regional. Also with their counterpart government institutions. So communication is a major challenge for associations that are operating in transitional economy. The fourth point, there is a place at the back. The fourth point, there is inability to adjust to the right kind of management system. Many associations or chambers inherited the old system, this top-down kind of approach. So that somehow limited the participation of the private sector in each local associations. And the last, not least, the major challenge, lack of legal infrastructure. Not only that, some associations, they are adherent to a very old kind of archaic laws, which is not compatible to, you know, the current situation. So these are some of the challenges of business associations that are working in transitional economy, like Somaliland or Ethiopia. How a business association could provide value-added services? They could engage or provide different kind of services for their members and non-members, but they have to be very careful and they have to test before they engage in any kind of activity at a larger scale. The first kind of parameter for any kind of service is that the program should be consistent enough with the organization mission and the vision. Unless associations, by nature, they are non-profit organization, even though they are supporting profit business entities, so they should not driven only by profit. So any kind of service or programs they are providing, it should be consistent enough with organization mission and vision. The second parameter, any kind of service should be demand driven. They should consult, they should have some kind of assessment or research whenever they develop a service or programs finally for the benefit of their members. And the third parameter, they should have some kind of technical as well as human resource to sustain programs. They could not provide programs and services using external consultants for a long time. So they should have in-house capacity, financial capacity, as well as technical, and also human resource capacity to provide long-term kind of services. The fourth parameter, associations should be very careful in having ultimately desired outcomes. So what kind of outcomes do they expect at the end of the service beyond collecting a revenue? The final point, very important, any association or chamber, they shouldn't compete or duplicate the efforts of services that are provided by other organizations or members. They shouldn't compete with their own members, so they should careful when they design programs and services. Some of the examples on service or programs, it could be business information or certification. Some countries, especially on import and export, they need some kind of certificate of origin from the product that comes. I don't know. I heard yesterday that Somaliland is exporting cattle to Saudi Arabia. So I'm not sure whether the Saudi people are expecting some kind of health certification for exporting cattle. Maybe the guy who was raising this issue is with us today will give us more elaboration after my presentation. Other service, it could be publications. They could have hard copy or electronic kind of publications. It could be a membership directory, newsletter, or tourism kind of publications. And finally, they could also have some kind of networking meetings based on fee by bringing business to business arrangement, and also by arranging buyers and sellers. The final major topic, the role of business association in policy advocacy. There are two major reasons why associations are engaged on public policy advocacy. The first thing, business, they need to make their voice to be heard by the public, by the government, by the media, by the legislative body, or by the administration. So whenever they advocate, they could use media, which is TV, radio, newspapers, and these days also social media. And also they could lobby as lawmakers, especially the parliamentarian. The second major reason, associations, they need to strengthen their business associations by articulating members' concerns and interests. They could also meet regularly with the decision makers. They could have some kind of format. Maybe I'm not sure whether it's a good example or not for Somaliland. In Ethiopia, each region, especially the major regions, they have a public-private dialogue format on a regular basis. Four times with different kind of ministries, and also once in every year with the prime minister. So they deal their local issues as a low level of administration system, and some issues are the federal issues, so they brought their issues annually to be addressed by the higher level policymakers with the presence of the prime minister. So that kind of channel could be formulated here in Somaliland. So briefly my presentation, so we'll go directly to the expertise on this issue. So let me invite Abdirashid to say the role of his association, the chamber, and also to say a few words how his association would like to engage in the national development program two, which is a vision of 2030. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Abdirashid Hussein. My voice is not very loud, but I'll try. The presentation is about Somaliland Chamber of Commerce and the role they're playing in the country. I'll start with a brief introduction by saying that the chamber was established in 1993 on 25th October with a public law number 35. And the current chair is Mohamed Shugri, and the Secretary General is called Ibrahim. So I'd like to talk about the vision and the mission. The vision of Somaliland Chamber is to forge new commercial operations and opportunities between Somaliland and the rest of the world. That's the vision of the Chamber. And the mission is to guide and assist in all types of business, both importers and exporters, in local and international arena. Just to continue on the membership, Somaliland Chamber is a business organization which is independent from government. It is an organization whose membership is open to all business entities. We also have what we call membership subscription, which is done yearly, and members pay some sort of fee. I wanted to take some time and talk about the functions of the chamber. There are so many functions of any chamber around the world. And just like any other chamber around the world, Somaliland Chamber has a lot of functions, but I will pick on the main ones. The first one is to represent and safeguard the interests of the members and the business community in general. So the chamber works for the interest of the business community in the country. That's the main. To promote the national economy through encouragement of production of both export-oriented and import-oriented. To organize trade fairs, just like this trade fair, the one that we have, or the Somaliland Investment Conference. The Chamber also organizes investment conference both within the country and outside the country. And also to seek market for the products of Somaliland, both internal market and external market. The other thing is to ensure that we promote business practices and provide the best services to members. The Chamber also collects information and compiles this information and tries to disseminate information to do with trade, commerce, industry, agriculture, and fisheries. Those are some of the sectors that we work. The Chamber also, in Somaliland or in any other country, they create a directorate, a trade directorate, just like this one that I have in my hand right now. The other thing is to organize trade fairs, which I've spoken about. Also, Somaliland Chamber tries to have relationship with both regional and international chambers. At the moment, Somaliland Chamber has signed an MOU with Pan-Africa Chamber. It has signed an MOU with East Africa Chamber. So this shows that there is relationship with the chambers, both locally and internationally. Also, we try to receive business delegations that come from both within the country and outside the country. The other important thing is to ensure that any problems that affect business community is solved by the chamber. So some of the services that the chamber has spoken about, Mr. Haile, but I will repeat a few of them.
The chamber offers services in terms of general assistance on trade and investment opportunities. So if you come to any chamber around the world, that's where you get information on trade. It also offers things like business and trade documents. So in the chamber, you're supposed to have some of the documents that as an investor, when you need to make a business, you need to find information. I think at our chamber, there may be some sort of challenges. I know a question will come, do you have such information? But it's trying to improve, and we are aware. We host trainings, seminars, and workshops for business communities. Still, at the moment, we are not very strong in that area. But however, on issues to do with defining the interests and the rights of the chamber members about the opinions to either business or private sector or public, any problem they have. He has spoken about the issue of certificate of origin. The chamber gives out certificate of origin to members. In case there is also disputes commercially, Somaliland Chamber offers arbitration services. When the government is trying to do laws, the chamber is part of the team that go and discuss with the government. And just to add on the same, there is a public-private dialogue in Somaliland that has been started with the Ministry of Trade, the Chamber of Commerce, and the Office of the President. Lastly, I wanted to just hint on the five sectors that Somaliland Chamber works on. The first sector is the livestock sector, where we offer some services. There's the agriculture and fishing sector, the industry and commercial sector, and general trading. Those are the five services that the sectors that the chamber works with. So that was my brief.
Excellent. Thank you. So I will go next to Jamaal.
السلام عليكم. I'm Mr. Jamaal, Vice Chairman of National Industry Association. So I will give you some brief of my background of National Industry Association. Sorry about that mistake. That's the background of National Industry Association. Was founded in 2003 by a group of entrepreneurs who recognized the need for unifying the organization that's representing all local industries in Somalia. The National Industry Association is registered with the Somaliland Ministry of Industries under the Article of 23 of Somaliland National Constitution. NIA is an independent, non-political, and non-governmental organization. We started about 56 light and medium industries. Unfortunately, only 21 are functioning now because of many challenges here, and I will tell them something. Somaliland manufacturing sector and is dedicated to the development and promotion of local industries. NIA is the first and only industry association that has been established in Somaliland, and its priority is to build industrial sector. The fishing. To be the regional leading association that's dedicated to influence the future direction of Somaliland industrial sector through promoting, developing, innovating, and protecting the interest of local industries. Our mission is also to be the first organization for industrial stakeholders, an association group is in relation to any and all matters affecting all of industrialization and economic development. Increase the national income, higher standard of living, economic stability, improvement in balance of payments, It stimulates workers in other sectors, increasing employment opportunities, promotes specialization. Rise in agricultural production, easy to control industrial activity, large scope for technical progress, increasing savings and investment, development of markets, increase in the government giving. And also enhance the balance of payment, increasing the domestic production, increasing employment opportunities. Factors leading in the serial variant, high cost of production inputs like energy, utilities, and raw material. Mismatch between output of education system and industry skill needs. Low labor productivity and manufacturing. Shortage of locally available skilled labor. Labor cost is an inadequate wage. Unreliable supply of raw materials and industrial inputs. Lack of capital banks for financing the sector. Competition from cheap imports from our neighbor countries and other Arabian countries. Challenges with property rights and security of land. Occupations, poor infrastructure and partly main roads and feeder roads resulting in high transport costs. Lack of market. The only market is local in Somaliland. Our production cannot reach our neighbor countries like Ethiopia and Djibouti because of their high tariffs. We cannot go through it. Also, the problem is the bank. We don't have bank-to-bank capacity to open a letter of credit. So our main problem is in the market. Our recommendation is formulating an industrial policy and strategy to choose suitable foreign markets, technical improvement, especially labor skills, suitable banks, especially letter of credit, getting better letter of credit. Establishing industrial zones in all regions because our factories are individually in some different areas. Everyone has used to his own generators and electricity, his own water. So if we get an industrial zone, we can then combine for all these utilities. Promoting import substitutions in diversification, establishing industry, encouraging export-oriented industries, access feasibility studies for industrial sectors. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamaal. So the next panelist will be Mr.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today here I am wearing two hats. One is and presenting Somaliland Economic Association, and also I am an academic from University of Hargeisa. So the chambers and how they work and associations have been discussed in detail. But my points will be provocative, so that we will have a discussion on the role of chambers and their relevance in the 21st century. So I will start first on the legality and models of chambers. As we know that the Somaliland Chamber of Commerce established by law in 1993, as Abdirashid mentioned. So we can ask, is this chamber a government organ or it is established voluntarily by the business community? So for example, if we take Ethiopia, they have three kind of laws concerning chambers in 1943 when the imperial was there, in 1973 with the new government in the direct regime, which is a socialist system, and then in 1994 with the a free market based system. So we have to ask, what kind of legality we have in Somaliland. Are we still having the socialist mentality in organizing our business? For example, if you want to register a business in Somaliland, it is mandatory that you register with the Chamber of Commerce. And the money you have to pay is $50, which is about 18%. 18% of the cost of establishing a business, which is a very big number. So the other thing is, if you have to pay that $50, I have been asking around for the last 1 week. I visited different businesses. I asked how they have registered their business. So most of them, they will tell you, when you ask about the Chamber of Commerce, they will say, we don't know what they are doing. So when you ask them why you are registered, why you are a member, what they are going to tell you is that it is because it is mandatory to register. So that means they are not participating, they are not getting anything back on the money they have produced. So that is something that we should discuss here. The other thing is, in general, are chambers of commerce losing relevance? Nowadays, we have technology, and you can easily have your own beautiful website. You can advertise your business in the social media. So you can ask, why do we need we need a Chamber of Commerce? And how can the Chamber of Commerce compete with the changing technology? That's also another thing we should consider. The other thing we should see is that we should talk about also advocacy. I think we haven't raised that point yet. Our Chambers of Commerce, how they will advocate for business freedom, business opportunities, what kind of models and what kind of a process we will follow when we are advocating for such kind of advocacy. And when we talk about advocacy, an important word will be having collusions. Collusions, for example, we have business associations. We also have professional associations. So if you want to do advocacy for local business and the economy, how can we have such kind of a collusion? How can we have a common ground with different associations so that we can have a point or institutional rules, resources allocations and appointments? And how can we make an output, policy outputs, and how can we look after those policies until they have an impact on the business community? So these are the things we will have to discuss in this session. The last thing I have to mention is also that what kind of a process we should follow. If we want to make advocacy for business, what kind of a process we should follow. Later on I will make suggestions on the points or the steps we'll take, but I will wind up my intervention here. Thank you very much. I haven't spoken about the Somaliland Economic Association because more of what we are discussing here is business related. But Somaliland Economic Association was established in 1993, in 2013. And as far as the association is concerned, our vision the main point is to advocacy of policy, especially an economic policy within the society and the government. So we have been organizing debates on the Somalian economy. The last one we had was on the dollarization of the Somalian economy. and how can it have an impact on the economy as general, whether it is good for the economy because the Somaliland is not a recognized country, or it has a bad impact. Also, how can we choose between these two? So that is Somaliland Economic Association. And in general, when I am talking about creating coalitions between associations, I am talking about associations like those are professional associations like accounting association, health association, economic associations, which are based on which are professional associations, and those business associations like women's associations and business. We have industry associations. We have the Chamber of Commerce. So how can we, you know, work together? These are the things also we should discuss, because professional associations usually do research, and this research can be used as an advocacy tool.
Thank you, Warsame. So shall we make the discussion after the last presentation?
Yeah.
Okay. So I would like to invite Sucaad. Sucaad, and we'll come back to the discussion. Sucaad, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you, because you have actually touched quite a lot of stuff, and you will then realize why we had to set up our own association, because of the services that are not available to women who are running businesses. I would like to tell you a little bit history, how association for women in business started. We have been really as a group of women who have run businesses. We had a difficult experiences when it comes to the markets that we have been actually starting our businesses in. It was male dominated, and often the gatekeepers were men, and we were not getting information, we were not getting exposure that you need as a business woman. And we realized only when we are talking about the economy and we're talking about businesses, the focus only are on men. If I take an example, for instance, one of the things that we have asked ourselves is, because we are a member of the Chamber of Commerce, as my friend here said, it's a compulsory. When you're getting your license, you have to actually register yourself with the Chamber of Commerce and pay that $50. It's mandatory. But we actually ask ourselves what exactly the Chamber is doing for us in return of the money that we're paying. And because it's mandatory, they had no competition for them to improve their services for women specifically. They were taking part and going to business fairs in Turkey, in so many other places, where they were getting exposure, but they have never invited women in business. And we always used to find information after everything has been done and happened. We have also realized that the contracts that the government is awarding, we don't get the information on those kind of contracts, because men tell the other men, and the Chamber of Commerce dominated by men, we kind of realize that maybe it's been designed for men in business, not for women. And I'm not being really, negative about the Chamber, because they obviously do a lot of work, but they haven't been doing the work that we needed for us. So we have been fortunate enough to be invited to attend a training, five women from Somaliland, to Uganda, and to take part in a training that was put up on by ILO and run by CIPE. And then through that training, we realized what we needed was to have our own Chamber of Commerce to address the issues that matters to women who are running businesses. So then we, when we came back, we didn't sit on the training that we have actually got from that 10-day training in Uganda. We established our own association, which is called Association for Women in Business. The main purpose and the main aims and objectives of is for this association is to empower women in business, to advocate for them, to address the issues that matters to us, like accessing funds. An association in this century and in this year, 2016, matters quite a lot because it gives us a voice, a platform to address the issues that matters to us. So it's still relevant, but it will not be relevant if it's not addressing what the women who are running businesses in Somaliland need. Like coming here, I'm trying to inform everybody that there are a sector and huge part of the society in this community in Somaliland that have been ignored time and time again. We're not, you know, we can run big businesses, we can invest businesses, but almost as though that we don't matter, and that business is something men talk about, and it's for mature people, and mature people in this part of the world are men, sort of, that we are sidelined. So the association here is about giving a platform women, and also one of the things that we really want to look at it is a research, a proper research that's been to do in terms of how many women who run businesses in Somaliland actually have accounts, how many have actually have got license to run their businesses, and actually empower women or encourage women to formalize their businesses. They might be running a small shop, which is very successful small shop, but the reality is because it's not registered properly and it hasn't been gone through the proper channels, which sometimes are difficult because as we talked about yesterday, there is no one-stop shop where you can go and get all your things done. So in terms of being a competition to the chamber, what we want is to help women to connect with the chamber and also advocate for them so that the chamber can get their act together and not ignore women and provide services that actually matters to us. One of the other things that we need is banks and the financial institutions to take a lesson and to take serious about women's and women, women who are running businesses. Often they might not own or have accounts, which means that they can't really, they're not part of the formal sort of a sector of the business. They're always running their business informally. So the other thing we want to do is to encourage women to have bank accounts, to be part of the financial system, to demand services that are geared towards women who are running businesses. So that's what this association is all about. And I would like to say this in Somali, if you don't mind, because there are women here who doesn't speak English. And hadan dib in yar ugu soo noqdo horta ragan intooda badan waxay ka hadlayeen waxa weeyaan associations ka jira iyo siyaasadaha uu noqon karo en halkan da sida la idin ku sheegay waxay noo fadhiya en chamber ki ba fadhiya en muxuu haye iyo qoloyin kale iyo laftigooda association la saadu maqaleysan I hope ina fahanteen taas waxaan doonayaa in intaydi hadan af Soomaali ku sheego association kan wuxuu ka aasaasmay baahi aan anagu garanay inay jirto oo anagana qabsatay haddaan nahay dumarka meheradaha leh oo ay ka mid tahay in waxa ugu muhiimsan markay noqoto markaad haysatid ganacsata aad tahay waxyaabaha ugu muhiimsan waxa weeyaan inaad hesho war معلومات كسابسن وحيابه يعني كهرم مرين لهيد نحوها جناحستي هنجرينتي إيمان كقول هالخافر جدا وحي كجناحستها فاحة فاحة أي إبساء ككنت عرقابه نحوها يلا أكله وحي أبا هنتها مال أي برودكت كذي وحيدا كوهر جلسو أما يكو أجاتو إنفورميشن كسابسن بيجي كهرم مرين لها een ganacsiga ay wadato marka waxaan ogaanay dumarka marka ay noqoto in aan waxyaabaha soo dhinay naga dhiman yihiin marka association kan aanu abaabulnay waxaanu abaabulnay in dumarku ka faa'iideystaan oo aanu noqono af u hadla marka u baahan yihiin in cid u hadasho marka kalena ay noqono meel aad u timaadid in aad ka hesho wararka ku saabsan sidii aad ganacsigaaga aad horumar u gaarsiin lahayd waayo in muxuu ha dumar ku xubahan yihiin inay muxuu ha wax goostaan in cidna waxa ma siinayso marka associationka waxaan ugu tala galnay in dumar koodan regionka doonaan baa ka yimaadaan ay ka qayb galaan in kuntiina waxaanoo hirgeliyay anagoo ka qayb galnay muxuu ha training lagu sameeyay Uganda oo lagu bariyay dadka sida ay u sameysan lahaayeen association tamarkii aan tagnay ayaan dib u soo noqonay association kan aan bilownay imika 150 dumar ayaa naga member naga ah intii kale doonaysay in member naga noqoto ama wakiil naga noqoto gobolada kale ku yimaadeena waa welcome ujeedada ugu weyn waxa weeyaan inaan dumarka hor u marino hadii aanay baananka la xiriirin oo aanay baananka aanay account ku lahayn barno siyaabihii ay u noqon lahaa business-ka ay rangareen ama ay wataan ama ay ka shaqeystaan inu noqdo mid u tirsan ee dawladda haday noqoto research haday noqoto mid tirsan sida aan imika u nahay dad qarsoon oo aan muuqan inay noqono dad muuqda oo tusa ragga inaynu businessya waaweyn geli karno inaan lacag haysano lacagteena gelin karno waxa intaan ku daray inkastoo aan ingiriis koro waxa aqal dhisan inaga dhisnay waxa reer la biiliyana inaga biilina marka waxay inaan ismuujino inaan ujeedada marka association ku waa kaas waana yar ku leelay raali
ah I'm sure will be the same version with English.
Yes.
Almost. Maybe a few different.
Thank you so much. It's a very practical intervention. Yeah. So the floor is open for questions, discussions, and any kind of reflection. Thank you. So let me start the gentleman here.
My name is Ahmed.
Sorry? Please introduce your name and the organization you represent.
My name is Ali Ahmed. I have two hats. I'm the chair of Mandar Food Company, but also I'm a team from Cardiff University who are doing research here. Therefore, I have those two hats. I'd like to really commend Chamber of Commerce, because the reason I'm saying that is that they made a partnership with the East African Chamber of Association and also Pan Africa. Because I was one of the people who were campaigning there. And I think you know, Jamaal knows as well as Abdirashid. And that was about 3 years ago. Therefore, today we heard that they have that link. And that's an achievement, I have to say. The other thing is, I never heard that Somaliland, you know, is basing on socialism, you know, in the commerce side. But I'm hearing, I can understand about Ethiopia, I can understand other countries, but I can't understand in Somaliland, or some were saying that. But even during the, you know, the regime of, you know, Siad Barre, the entrepreneurship wasn't killing, you know, in Somalia. I was one of them, you know, I was a businessman at that time. Therefore, what I'm saying, the entrepreneurship spirit is what Somaliland survived all through. All we need now is to really upskill that. And in our research that we have been doing, this was post economic recovery in Somaliland, the informal economy. We met so many different people. And the people we were looking at, those who are selling food, those who are selling milk, and we did a matchup. Here is Mubarak is here, Farwan is here, and Gulf University. We were all doing that partnership. And it's amazing what we heard, you know, from those who are underdogs, who are not represented here. I was here today, and I never heard, you know, that no organization, no friendly organization is talking about the informal economy and funding that. If we look at the employment of Somaliland, 80% is from that sector, and they are not getting any help. Therefore, we are advocating that. Our research will be published in January, and we are coming back, and we will share with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ali.
My name is Aydid. I am the Secretary General of the Somaliland Renewable Energy Association. I'm not just giving you a question, but I'm just trying to give you some information about the association. A very little few words of the association. The association was created this year, and because there was a need for all the local installers and local companies who are involved into the renewable energy sector, which had no protection, or which had no representation, and which had no where to go. So we created this association in which group is most of the renewable energy companies. Among them was Goli Solar, Kafi Solar, Solar Gen, Enerson, Adani Solar. All of those are among the association. And we created this just to participate in the development of the country, and also to advocate for the development of the technical aspect of the Somaliland renewable energy sector. So I'm just trying to give you that based on all of the information that you got from the association. And in terms of the Chamber of Commerce, we are a member, and most of those are members. We are good friends of the Chamber of Commerce, but we meet once a year. One is we want to renew the company, we just go there and we just say hi to them. And we don't see any other services that come. So we are just inviting the Chamber of Commerce also to come out, to reach out to all of the other members so that they will participate in the development of the sector. I never voted, I'm a member. I don't know if I have voting rights. I never voted. I was never invited to vote for an election or whatever. And I don't know when the next election is going to be, so that, or if I have the right to vote.
I'm sure we are.
Should I stand up? Okay. My name is Saadia Ahmed. I'm a Kenter representative from Panha. It's good to hear what the Chamber of Commerce is really working, but the reality of the situation in this country is we have got one of the most expensive. In terms of utility, of the prices of food and everything else, the economy, I don't know what you call it economy, because it's getting very fastly expensive. Whose remit is it to actually look at the markets and make sure that we are not really being ripped? There are a lot of associations. Electricity is mostly expensive, most expensive I think in this region and everywhere in the world. Water is very expensive. Everything you touch is really, really, really becoming very difficult. So, and it's the interest of the industrial, not only the industry, but the business sector. It's the interest of the business sector to be able to sell things and to be able to have an affordable commodities that people can buy. Because if you make everything very expensive, then only the few can buy and the rest have to be dependent on remittance or something else. I really like to know what's your stand on this one.
Thank you
very much.
Thank
you. My name is Mubarak. I'm the director of planning at the Ministry of National Planning and Development. I'm also from the academia. Actually, my question is to both industry association and the Chamber of Commerce. In 2014, I have conducted a research on the determinants of small and medium enterprises growth. One of the findings of that research was actually I have met with, you know, the business associations, including, you know, the association, the industries association, Chamber of Commerce, and many others. And my research was actually focusing on only the manufacturing sector. You know, the businesses or the investors do not actually undertake a proper feasibility study when they are actually taking, when they are taking, you know, investment decisions, or when they are taking a decision on where to invest. And my question is, what is the role of the Chamber of Commerce? What is the role of, you know, the Industries Association to actually provide businesses and investors, advices, or, you know, provide actually, you know, recommendations of, on, you know, what are the potential sectors to invest? What are the challenges out there in each sector? And what, you know, studies and, you know, actually surveys have already been conducted. Just, you know, to make, just, you know, to avail a first-hand information that the businesses can take decision on. So what's your role in actually solving that particular problem? The government is doing a lot. You know, the Ministry of Trade is doing a lot in actually promoting the business environment. We, Ministry of National Planning and Development, is actually taking, you know, taking a role to, you know, promote the investment and the you know, business environment and the investment climate of the country. But we are lacking the role of the businesses in actually solving these problems. The other question is, our economy is actually is dominated by the informal sector, I can say, as Eid has already, you know, highlighted. If you look at the formal business sector and the informal business sector, we can say the informal business sector is actually, you know, it can outweigh the formal business sector, I can say. And it is difficult to regulate an economy which is very, very informal from the government perspective. And it's also very, very difficult to survive in this very dynamic business environment in the first 20th century. Being informal is a problem. So my question is, what is the role of the Chamber of Commerce as well as the business association is to formalize the businesses so that we can, you know, actually, you know, promote the economic development of the country as well as fight for the rights of these, you know, informal businesses. Who are the breadwinners of, you know, of the poor families. And maybe it's a comment and it's also a question to you know, Industries Association. You have said one of the key challenges that we are currently facing is lack of market. You have, your argument is we have you know, only local market, but there is no market in the neighboring countries and elsewhere. Actually, I have a different view. I don't think there is a lack of market. There is a big market in all of the region. And you have actually touched upon that there are obstacles, like, for example, high tariffs. My question is, what initiatives have you put in place to actually, you know, to tap the potential markets in the region? Have you conducted a research on what obstacles are deterring you to go into these, you know, markets in the region as well as, you know, elsewhere in the world? So thank you very much.
Thank you. I think my concern mainly is whether or not the Chamber of Commerce has any quality control department, particularly in the import of dangerous products, such as pharmaceutical products. We all know that anybody who has a little bit of money, can import pharmaceutical products and dispense them as they wish, not knowing about side effects, not knowing about the dangers and the reactions that these pharmaceutical products can cause. And the contents of those medicines may not always correspond to the label on the package. It may say that there is a certain dose on the package, but in reality, the medicine itself does not have the active products that you have. So, if there is, I'd like to know about it. And if there is not, I would suggest and recommend that they should be a very strict regulatory bodies that allow people to import drugs that do not conform to the safety standards of these pharmaceutical products. Thank you.
Thank you. So there are many questions. Let's go. First round up. Respond and I'll come back to you. Is that okay?
Yeah.
So most of the questions are forwarded to Abdirashid, the Chamber and Industry Association. So I'll give you 2-3 minutes each to tackle these questions. Thank you. So,
thank you. There has been so many questions raised to the Chamber. I'll start with the last question raised by Dr. Edna. On whether there is a quality control department in Somaliland Chamber. We do not have a quality control at the Chamber as a department, but this is at the government. We are aware the government of Somaliland has a quality control body, and this is a role of the government, but we will look into your recommendation, the one that you have given, on whether as a chamber. But from my experience with working with chambers around the world, I haven't seen a chamber that has a quality control, a big department. But yes, there is a licensing department, but maybe we can look into having that recommendation taken. The other question was raised by Mubarak on informal, what does the chamber do for informal businesses? The chamber tries to provide some sort of business trainings to informal business, try to give some sort of market information. But however, I'll want to say this as an issue, that like any other institution in Somaliland, Somaliland Chamber is a growing institution. It is growing. We have not been giving all that support, but it's something that we are looking into. You also, there's somebody who raised the question on, it's still Mubarak, who said, what does Somaliland Chamber do in terms of providing investors with information? You'll realize that the Ministry of Trade, together with the Chamber of Commerce, formed the Somaliland Investment Guide. It wasn't just formed by the Ministry of Trade, but there was support provided by the Chamber to form. Okay, feasibility studies is also something that the research department of the Chamber is looking into. It's a growing institution, just like any other institution in Somaliland. It's something that we will also look at. I think on the question raised on high prices of electricity, I will leave for the Industry Association to answer that. But I wanted to take 2 questions raised by our panelists. One of the questions was that you take money from us, but what do you do? First of all, just to correct, an individual pays $18, but companies are the ones that pay $50. So it's not like every individual that walks into the chamber pays $50. It is companies that pay $50. This money has been used to construct a 2-story building for the chamber as an office. You can imagine building a 2-story building. It's not an easy thing as such. But however, I don't want to only dwell on the building. Some of the part of the money has been used. We have 320 women entrepreneurs registered with the Chamber of Commerce. The Chamber has tried to give information to associations. So it's trying, but we know that Somaliland, all institutions are growing. It's not an institution that is very strong, but it's an institution that is trying to see what it can do. On the issue of legality of the chamber was formed by a public law number 35 as an independent entity. So those are some of the things that I wanted to raise very quickly. So with associations, we are trying to work with them. And that training in Uganda, we were also supposed to come, but unfortunately, we didn't have the time to come. So it's something that we are trying to look, and I think the recommendations are good, and we will work with the associations far more better in the future.
Okay, thank you. So, Jamaal?
I would like to answer about the question of the market. We have about 21 industry works now in Somaliland. The biggest one is for the Coca-Cola company, which is the large company. We have two medium detergent factory. They work only 1 month for the whole 12 months because of the lack of the market. In Ethiopia and Djibouti, their tariffs are very high. As you know, we are not recognized. We don't have really, or our government didn't do anything about that matter about their friends in Ethiopia. Their tariffs are very, very high. Our products go to Ethiopia through informal, not through the customs. And that's very dangerous also. If you get challenged one or two times, the third time you are in the hand of the police. So our main challenge is that problem for the market. About the visibility still. You know, our people are very shrewd for the business. They didn't ask you about what's good or what they want to be to get benefit. For example, today I was in my office. We got 12 factories for water. And we don't have market also, as I told you, on the local market. Today, a new one come to me by my office who just want to register his new machines and company. And the other 13 factories has no market. They are all not producing their capacity. So our constitution is written free market economy. So you cannot make to stop anybody. But we got our website. We told them if you were, we make meetings. So that's what the only way we reach them. So thank you.
Thank you so much. So it's a very active group. I don't want to limit the discussion, but for the sake of time, I'm going to accept only two very short questions because there is another session on Investment Act. So let me, one question on this side and another one maybe from the lady. So, sir.
I want to talk about two things, two different flavors. One is the Chamber of Commerce. I'm a member of the Industrial Association, National Industrial Association, and I'm in the board. And by default, I'm a member of the Chamber of Commerce. Chamber of Commerce, although they have not reached where we want them to be, and they do, and they don't do all of the things that we want them to do, to their credit, they are trying their best. This is an organization that should consist of six different industrial associations that bring information and support and capacity from top up. From our industrial association, we have two members in the Chamber of Association. And industrial association is the only association in this sector. This is not from gender. It is in industries, whether it's a culture, whether it's our association is all one of it. They have not done all of the things, and we always bash them. But they are trying their best. Because of lack of capacity for the Chamber of Commerce and the other associations at the grassroots level, not much could be done at all. What we need is funding and support for capacity building for the grassroots associations so that things can move forward. Ideas will come from the bottom. Needs, specific needs can be placed at the top. And the Chamber of Commerce can move forward and do whatever they are supposed to do. He mentioned about the Chamber of Commerce representative, Jamaal. This is the question I was going to ask. He mentioned a little bit about it, about the disparity. But you will not go through the border between Ethiopia and Somaliland. Products come from Ethiopia, but my product cannot go to Ethiopia. That is, and we don't know why Ethiopia is placing high tariffs while their products are coming free of tariffs. I have a factory water bottle. You said he mentioned about the water bottle, bottling plants. Water bottle, bottled water from Chigiga is sold in the supermarkets like this. Milk from Chigiga, camels are sold. But the milk from here, I produce yogurt. I cannot sell my yogurt until. The Chamber of Commerce were supposed to pick up that problem. But because of their lack of capacity, I would rather we develop them. We sort of empower them. We add capacity to their current work rather than patching them. I had many problems with them. Jamaal knows, I always, wherever we come together, I'm always patching them. But at this point in time, we have no other organization that can do this.
Thank you so much. You're welcome.
Yeah, I'm sorry, because I like to ask you.
Thank you for that. My name is Ghani Abdi'Alin. I have a company called Diamond Fashion Tailor. So mainly what our product is for tailoring for the fashion design is for the ladies, and tailoring for the uniforms, which is and as well as fashion, and then also producing the suits. Everyone now is wearing for suits, so we are producing as a locally for the suits and the safari suits. So all Somalis is welcome to visit for us for Diamond Fashion Tailor. Yes, thank you for that. And the second name is. And you can see the trail to our product is really not in brochure. So anyone is interested to us, maybe we can meet and discuss for that later on. Thank you. And I will come to the in question for the Chamber of Commerce. Thank you all of you for the association and the Chamber of Association and the SIPE. And I will ask you for if it is possible. You know, we are interested also always to pick up for the women's issue in the higher level, since the women issue is we are feeling like vulnerability, but we are strong and we cannot see that. But we need also to then and to ask for question for the Chamber of Commerce. And you know, the Chamber of Commerce consists of so many sectors, and we have only for one lady. Is it possible to have chamber, which is called Somaliland Chamber Association, which is separate department? If it's possible, think about that. It's a common, not to answer. And the second thing is, you know, when it comes to the and resources, we are feeling and like women are always, there is many conferences where, and me, I am a member for the Chamber of Commerce. But we are registered, which is good and which is legal, but nothing comes back to us. So we don't know if it is only for ladies or if it is men with us for that. So we are asking for them. Thank you.
Last question. I don't give you the last lady, she's having her hand. So make it short.
Sure.
Thank you. My name is Amina Adams. I'm the owner of Pay Uniforms. Pay Uniforms makes students and corporate uniforms. So if I go to my question, there is something which is burning myself, because we produce uniforms. And also a member of one of the women associations. It's called the Somaliland Women Entrepreneurship Association. So we worked the whole 12 months. We have 49 staffs. And then we provide schools. We have schools that we have already contracted. And also the other schools, they came to us because of the quality and the price. So what is happening this year, although we are taking part of the job creation, and I told you that we have 49 staff, and 30 of them, they are female. What we are trying to stop the ready-made uniform that bring from China for only one person. And that person, he works the other time for another sector, but the time back to school, he go to China and then bring, while we are working the whole 2 months, and we are keeping staff. Above of that, what happened this year, the uniforms that we made, we get the Ministry of Education, he said all schools, they are only wearing uniforms. The parents, when they come to buy it, they say, we don't know what to buy, because we have the Ministry of Education, they say all the uniforms, they are same. So what happened this year, we lost, I'm telling you. And you are saying, as Chamber of Commerce, you are talking for the voice of the business. And the business association for the female, they are new. They cannot talk to us. You see, the product that we are producing above of the uniforms, we make the bags. We make corporate uniforms. Right now, yesterday, we delivered 700 uniforms for SBI, the Coca-Cola company. So in still supporting the local product, I think we are not looking for the economic growth of this country. We are supporting individuals. So that's what...
I wish we have more time. It's a very active audience, honestly speaking. But as I said, we have a limitation of time. We have to stop. But before we conclude this session, I would like to say thank you so much for the four panelists for their time and expertise kind of reflection in relation to this topic. Also, I would like to say thank you the organizers, Shuraako, Lee and his team. And my special thanks go to this very active audience. But last, the gentleman over there, he was raising about the issue of tariff in relation to some of the products Somaliland to Ethiopia. Even though I'm not a government official, but still I could raise this issue to the National Chamber, to the Ethiopian Chamber of Commerce and the Sectoral Association. They have a special kind of a department. So it's very useful to have some kind of still the details open for discussion. And finally, the two governments, the Ethiopian government and the Somali government, will decide. But still, as a partner for the Ethiopian private sector, I could raise your concern to the concerned high leaders of the private sector. And I promise I will facilitate some kind of also engagement between the two chambers, the Ethiopian chamber, as well as the Somaliland Chamber of Commerce. So thank you.